We have found that our current approach to water supply is not sustainable as it is now. Aquifers are being depleted, lakes, streams, and wetlands are being damaged, and in some areas, groundwater levels have declined as much as 40 feet, roughly 1 foot each year since the 1970s. The metro area accounts for about half the water demand in the entire state, and now just about a third is supplied from surface water, that is river water, and about two-thirds from aquifers, or groundwater. This reflects a dramatic shift over the post-World War II era. This graph shows the ratio of surface water to groundwater use in the region. Surface water is in red, groundwater is in blue. Somewhere around the end of the 70s, the balance shifted from mostly surface water to mostly groundwater. That shift has become more pronounced ever since. In earlier years, most new development took place near the core cities and relied on extensions of the existing Minneapolis and St. Paul water systems. Later, development moved to suburbs farther out and became more physically distant from these surface water-based systems, and the easiest option then became drilling wells. But that began putting strains on the layers of underground water, particularly the Prairie du Chien aquifer. That's the name given to the primary aquifer that serves most of the metro area. These are hydrographs, or graphs of water levels. They show data from three observation wells, one in Hugo, one in New Hope, and one in Bloomington. They show typical seasonal ups and downs in aquifer level, but they also clearly show a steady downward trend. We just picked these three to illustrate the topic. There are numerous others that show the very same trend, declining water levels over time. And that's part of the data, part of water supply issues that you can't see. So we have to rely on observation wells and water level data. But some effects you can see. This is White Bear Lake, and I'm sure you've heard about that. It's been in the press quite a lot lately. And while it seems funny to see someone cutting grass with a lawnmower on what used to be lake bottom, it's no laughing matter to the thousands of recreational users, business, and property owners in that part of our region. And White Bear Lake is not the only lake like this. It's just the one that's gotten the most publicity so far. So these are some of our findings so far, and that brings us to a natural question: what can be done about it? The message is clear: business as usual is not a solution. It's only going to exacerbate the problem. And so we need to take a different approach if we're going to maintain a sustainable water supply for expected growth by 2040 and for future generations beyond that. So we used our modeling capabilities to see what would happen if we did things differently. One of these what-if scenarios assumed that cities adjacent to existing surface water systems and along major rivers switched over to using surface water, treated river water, instead of groundwater. For this scenario, we also included the cities surrounding White Bear Lake, since that area is already starting to look at that option now. This is the same kind of map that you were just looking at, where the dark blues represented declining groundwater levels. In this case, the pink and related colors are showing increases in groundwater level, rebound in the aquifers. The result of the what-if scenario, where cities that most realistically could switch to surface water did so. As I said, in other words, the groundwater would actually begin to rise again under this scenario. And here the darkest pink indicates 10 feet of recovery or more. So we can project a major improvement if we were to reverse that trend toward using mostly groundwater for future population growth and instead rebalance the ratio of surface to groundwater. And that leads to the question: can the rivers handle that demand? This shows our three major rivers, kind of a stylized version of the three major rivers, and that the flow averages about 4.7 trillion gallons per year through the metro area. Our two major water supply systems that use river water, Minneapolis and St. Paul, together use about 39 billion gallons for water supply, or about 2% of the available flow. And both right now, with their current systems, including their treatment facilities, have considerable excess capacity already. rebalancing such as this would not happen easily. It would require extensive engineering and feasibility studies and design analyses to work out the details, not to mention the political agreements among the potential suppliers and customers of the resulting expanded systems. And most likely, one or more new surface water-based sub-regional coalitions would need to be formed to cover the area that would be necessary to bring the aquifers back up like that earlier slide showed. Meanwhile, we also need to focus on maintaining and enhancing groundwater recharge capacity of our aquifers by emphasizing lower impact development practices and create and take advantage of opportunities to reuse stormwater and wastewater. And as always, we need to continue to emphasize water conservation at the domestic, commercial, and industrial levels. And all of this is going to require quite a bit of collaboration at many levels, and it will be a challenge on so many levels. But obviously, the sooner we start, and you can fill in the rest of that, the sooner the better.